The Money Show. Personal finance.
So, Warren Ingram, the big question that we've asked everyone this evening is, in the year 1800, what was the average life expectancy? And we've got people clearly taking the mickey with no idea, saying, oh, 100. Because, hey, those were the good old days. No! 50, 40, 33 was the closest in Johannesburg. Mark, you were the closest at 33, but you're still way off. And it was only Sue in Cape Town that got it absolutely spot on. 20 years old.
And so, I mean, I know you're looking at me with bemused expression, and I guess that I'd like to just leave it there, but I know what you're telling me, that we have to tell people why, I guess.
Absolutely.
And the answer is because we started, or modern medicine started, to solve the problem of infant mortality. So there were lots of people, if you were able to get to, let's just say, early teenage years, then you had a pretty good chance of living quite a lot longer than 20. But actually, not even 65. That was very old. I mean, to live to 65 was a serious achievement. So the reason that it is the age 20 in the year 1800 was simply about infant mortality.
Yeah. By 1850, then people were living to be around 35 years old or thereabouts. And then, I suppose, the emergence of things like Alexander Fleming and penicillin. Suddenly, we see from the 1950s, the graphs spike upwards very, very sharply.
And that's what's interesting to me now, is that we for every year that we progress as a society, we're adding about 3 months to our life expectancy. So it's extremely likely that you and I are sitting here today, you know, where our parents might have comfortably expected to, I mean, okay, so your dad's
my dad just turned 90. I can't afford to do that.
Yeah, and so you, I mean, the likelihood is you comfortably outlive your parents' life expectancy, and at 90, I mean, you know, good luck with that.
So
you're in for it, Bruce. And so this is what got me thinking, is we're sitting here and I'm saying to myself, I wonder if we haven't really, if we shouldn't be turning this whole thing of retirement and this working career a little bit upside down. Because at the moment, the kind of pact that we make with ourselves and society is, you know, get educated, get working, and maybe somewhere around, hopefully the age of 25, you start saving. And
hopefully, but the tiny percentage of people even begin to contemplate the prospect that one day they might be old.
But let's just say this is the ideal. This is what society tells us to do. This is what I would be telling people to do. You know, get going. 25, you get cracking with as much saving as you possibly can. You work really hard. You have your 2.2 children, and you know you pay for your mortgage, and at the age 65, you chill out. And really enjoy life. So what it means is, you, from the age 25 to 45, you've got to pack in living, you've got to pack in all the things of your career, your family life, et cetera, and build up enough capital to then last you and sustain you for 30 years after you stop work. Now, it is possible. There are lots of people that have got that right, but there are multiples more who are never going to get it, get there. And then I start to think, well, actually, at the age of 65, I mean, the life that you can live from a health and mental ability, all that, to me is, I mean, you can be a really productive member of society. So are we not doing things wrong? In other words, shouldn't we maybe take a little bit of pressure off and say to people, you know, at the age 40, 45, what you need to be thinking about is, how do you maintain a set of skills and a kind of a work ethic that gets you to the point of being able to do something after the kind of formal retirement age? So if you are in the formal sector where you work for a big business and they say, look, 65 is the year, you know, no one works here past the age of 65, and you have to go out of that, what is it that you can do realistically to generate additional income? And I was just thinking, you know, if you're earning, let's say, 50,000 rand a month, which in South Africa is a heck of a salary, but let's just say you can get to that position, and the day you turn 66, you're in a position where you're earning only 15,000. Just to understand the impact of that, it's nearly a double swing, because it's not money that you're drawing from your savings or your investments. It's money that you're actually generating. So it's almost a 30,000 rand swing in your financial position. So to just generate that kind of money, it puts the life of your capital, it extends the life of your capital enormously.
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing that I'm that's sticking in my head is I think we need to change the deal we're making with society here.
Yeah, and society needs to also appreciate its older citizens more as well and realize that there is a huge amount of value to add for people once they retire. Lots of people get pushed out of corporate at the age of 60, which then extends the pressure that they're under to save. Because if you could leave your retirement savings that you've built up through your life and not add, say you get to 60 or 65 and don't add another cent to savings and just leave your money invested and then live purely off whatever cash that you can generate using your charm, your wit, your personality and your skills, doing part-time work. You don't have to be doing the same 5 a.m. to 9 p.m. that you've been doing for the last 40. You can do 3-4 days a week and live and still live a good life, but not touch those retirement savings and allow them to compound. By the time you get to a 70, 72, 75, you've actually then got a decent pile, a pool of retirement capital.
And I think in that time, you're living a much better quality of life, because you're working under a lot less pressure about, having to build up this career and this corporate ladder, et cetera, et cetera. And you've got this thing called time all of a sudden, and even if it is an extra day on a weekend, your weekends are suddenly three day weekends. That dramatic change in your lifestyle, I think is enormous. And what's interesting, looking at the people I know that have retired and have carried on working in one form or another, their health is much better. It's just absolutely a different ball game. They just don't kind of start going backwards from a health point of view. Their mental capacity is totally different. Aging's a bugger. You are going to degenerate. But the point is, if your brain's engaged and you've got things that you are forced in a positive way, forced to do, your brain stays engaged much better. And actually, you slow down that degeneration dramatically. And I think that's the thing about this is there's two aspects to me that really work here. Number one, after 65, you live a much better life. But before 65, and I'm kind of using 40 because I'm 42, so I'm talking to myself here. For 40 to 65, you can take some pressure off because now all of a sudden you don't need this, to build this massive pile of capital that has to sustain you. And there's never going to be another day of income once the day you've turned 65 and one day extra. You can actually change it. And I think there being able to say, okay, let me choose to work differently and spend more time on myself, on my skills, with my family, doing things that are more for enjoyment than just absolutely having to just make as much money as possible, where you end up either selling your soul or, selling time that actually you should be allocating to the family. I think that we can, you get a double benefit. And the more you enjoy work from the age of 40 to 65, the more you want to work.
Sure.
And that's the thing here.
Yeah, I mean, very few people have the luxury of being in formal employment after retirement because they do get pushed out of the space that they're in. They're seen as dead wood and they get pushed out, which creates the desperate need, I think, for so many South Africans to have a side hustle, whether that side hustle be driving the Uber or whatever it might be. Having the side hustle to sort of almost transition you into your post-work world of work.
So you're going to talk about purgatory after the news and in the small business world. And that to me is that's an absolute crying need there is to say, okay, there are lots of small businesses that cannot afford to take on an experienced person from the corporate world at that person's salary. But when that person's left the corporate world and they're more than willing to take a job that pays them 15 grand a month, but they're happy to impart their skills, their experience, their knowledge to a small business. I know when we started our company, I would have done anything to get a resource like that. Okay, it would have needed to be cheaper because we couldn't afford that.
No.
But the point is that I think people need to think very differently on both sides of the fence here. And then I think one of the things we're also realizing about human beings is we don't plan very well. So if we are 40, I know for myself, I can't really truthfully visualize myself at 65. I mean, it's still a kind of a concept, and I try really hard to think about, kind of drawing a picture very badly because I can't draw about what my house will look like and where I'll be and what my view will be and what kind of dogs will I have then, etc. Because as much as I can make it real, then I can work towards that goal. But that's actually not really human nature. So the last point to the people that are in that sort of age is, try and plan sort of over 5 or 10 year periods, because I think we can visualize that far ahead and break this up into selective goals to say, what do I need to do from a skills point of view to get there? What do I need to do from a financial point of view just to keep building my position, but not maybe under the enormous pressure that we've put ourselves under as a society? And I know the next time I'm on the show, I'll be saying, yeah, I've got to save and you've got to do all those things. And that's true. I'm not changing that. I'm not changing the story, but we can be realistic, I think.
Arrivederci. Warren Ingram, he's going on a holiday. Guess where? We're not talking to him for at least 3 weeks. And not because he's away, it's just because we're jealous. Great question, Gladwin. Thank you, Mohomotsi. This evening, what happened to Garth's portfolio that he was building up for his son, newly born at the time? Gladwin, there are two sons now, when I last checked. And we spoke to Garth McKenzie from Traders Corner. .co.za in January, and he did give us an update. The details of it escaped me. The last couple of years have been tough on those portfolios. He did create a portfolio of 10 shares for his first son, and then when his second son was born, he did the same as well. So he is persisting in the strategy. But if you go to traderscorner.co.za, he does do updates if you're interested in the luckiest kids in South Africa with a dad with that much vision on the day of their birth creating investment portfolios. Then traderscorner.co.za is the place to go. He's still here. Go on holiday. Thanks, Warren Ingram.